Variety called him one of the top 10 actors to watch in 2009, and since then, his career has continued to soar.
That's right. He starred in films like Fast and the Furious, Avatar, and Jumping the Broom, and now he plays a detective in the NBC series Mysteries of Laura. Laz Alonso, welcome back to Arise 360.
Yeah! Arise 360, baby!
Love that.
Thank you for having me back.
We're so happy to have you back.
I'm happy to be back,
Yay!
Too.
So
look at this wall. This wall is amazing.
It's
we
show
love
you.
Here.
Yeah.
That's right.
Well, Mysteries of Laura. This is great.
Yeah, it is great.
With it.
So you play Detective Billy Soto. Tell us about your character and what drew you to this project.
Well, you know, what really drew me to this project is comedy.
Yeah.
I've worked on a lot of serious stuff, mostly dramatic pieces, which I love, and that's my first love. But I've always wanted to have an opportunity to do comedy. And it's really hard to get into the whole comedy world in Hollywood. They say, you know, they typecast you in a certain area. And while that's not necessarily a bad thing, because typecast means you're working.
That's true. Mm-hmm.
You know, it's hard to break in and develop other areas, you know, of your repertoire. So when this opportunity came about, I jumped at it, especially the co-star opposite, you know, Deborah Messing, who is, you know, a television comedic icon, in my opinion.
Right. So did you watch Will and Grace when it was
on? You know, the funny thing is I always knew she was funny because everybody around me loved her,
uh-huh.
but I never watched Will and Grace. Like, I watch a lot of documentaries and wars, you know, documentaries and Discovery Channel.
Okay.
It still
like,
comes
I can
on.
Tell you,
you
how fast.
Watch.
I can tell you how fast, like, you know, a cheetah can dismember a wildebeest.
How fast?
But. We're not going to go there.
Okay, no details.
I can show you better than I can tell you. No, I'm kidding.
No, that's okay.
Let's watch.
No,
I'm kidding.
So, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, you know, but to have an opportunity to work with somebody who is always on comedically,
mm-hmm.
you know, it's developing muscles in me that, you know, I as an actor, it's great to always feel like you're back at the square one, you know, mm-hmm. back at the beginning, learning and getting better at something that, you know, you've always wanted to learn and didn't have an opportunity yet.
Well, is it difficult for you to flex your, you know, comedic muscles, or does it come naturally to you?
You know, now it's starting to come naturally.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're currently shooting, we're on episode 8 right now.
Okay.
So we've been here in New York filming since July. So, you know, in the very beginning, you know, when we did the pilot back in March, you know, you don't really know what to do or where the comedy really lives, but just being around it day in and day out, it wakes up in you. So you just come up with little things and they love it, and you hear like the camera guys laughing and you know, all right, I got a good one.
Right. Isn't that great? When they laugh, you know you've told something.
When
funny.
You can make the set burst out and erupt into laughter, then you know you got something.
All right. Well, we have a clip of you in action.
You
Let's take a look.
It? Yeah.
All right.
Where were you last night?
My daughter's gymnastics meet in Nyack. Not killing Krista Chase, obviously, that's why you're here.
Look, can you explain the assault charge that Krista filed against you?
Her aerial band came untied, she face planted on the floor like an idiot, and she blamed me as if I could have done that. Anyway, she dropped the charges, she kept coming to class.
Maybe she felt intimidated by you.
More like she needed to work out. You know, she really let herself go.
All right, look, something obviously went down between you two. What exactly? We can move this conversation to the precinct.
Charlie Carrazzo, my chooch ex-boyfriend, okay? Slut was seeing him.
Can the woman in jeans please evacuate the premises?
Namaste.
That is great.
That was hysterical.
Hey, man, you know. And that's just, you know, one of the scripted moments. The unscripted stuff, that's where all the, like, the gems are.
So how do you prepare to play a cop, actually? Do you do a ride-along with police officers? Do you learn how to hold a gun? How does it work?
We did a little bit of all that. Uh-huh. You know, we did ride-alongs. We toured different precincts in NY. Actually hung out with some homicide detectives, because that's what we play is homicide detectives. We also have a police person on set who's our advisor.
Okay.
You know, he's our technical advisor, and he makes sure that we don't make NYPD look terrible.
Yeah.
You know, so he's there to protect and make sure that we do everything procedurally correct. And Jack Cambria, who's, you know, he's one of the top hostage negotiators for New York City.
Really?
He's like the top dog, yeah. So it's great to feel that, you know, what you're doing, you have somebody to confer with so that you do it properly.
Makes
and
sure
has
it's
that
authentic.
Authenticity.
Yeah. Exactly. It's got to feel real.
So did you get to shoot a gun?
Yes. I mean, they're blanks. But, you know, it goes pow-pow.
Pow-pow.
It makes a little noise.
Okay.
I'm not going to go there.
Oh,
what are you thinking of?
Oh, no. of the gutter.
What else goes pow pow?
Out of the gutter. It's a family show.
Yeah, okay. That's how you ended up in that predicament. I'm kidding.
I'm blessed.
Maury! Where's Maury? No.
We do know who the father is. It's okay. We do know. Now she's going to be blushing for the rest of the show, I guarantee it. Oh, my God. Okay, so one of the other things.
See, comedic muscles.
That's great. Yeah, it is. It just comes naturally now.
Well, speaking of muscles,
okay.
You do have to take your shirt off sometimes on this show, correct?
No, not yet. We got to save that.
Oh, you're going to save
that? See, right now we got nice ratings.
Okay.
That's when things start going.
Okay.
Then you're like, all right, we need some skin. Somebody need to show some nipple real quick. It's
going
to be him.
Oh. Right.
No. So,
take it for the team.
Are you allowed to say nipples on TV?
You are allowed to say nipples.
Okay, cool.
Absolutely.
All of a sudden, I saw heads go down. I'm like, uh-oh. I'm about to get the plug. Sandman's going to come out here real quick. So, you know, we've been doing very well. Wednesday nights, 8 o'clock, that time slot, we've won it for 3 weeks in a row.
Congratulations.
Thank you. And, you know, everybody loves the show. You know, people go in not really knowing what to expect because they think it's another cop show. Mm-hmm. But we kind of, like, slide in a little comedy, a little humor in there. So it's a fun experience. Yeah. I always tell people it's just laid-back, fun TV, like the old school, you know, back in the days when you can laugh while you're watching TV.
Right. And you're so great at it and all your acting. And with your comedy now, I can't believe that you used to be on Wall Street working every day.
Oh, yeah, I hated it.
Investment banker.
I hated it.
So why did you make the leap into acting? And what did people say when you took that risk?
You know, I always wanted to be an actor. The reason why I came to Wall Street was to transition into acting. Mm-hmm. You know, at that time, you know, I studied the careers of Denzel, Sam Jackson, Forrest Whitaker, and all these guys did theater here in New York.
Yeah.
So I figured I got to go to New York, because if they're so good and they're doing so well, then I have to start where they did. Mm-hmm. And sure enough, you know, I came to New York, and while I was on Wall Street, because I felt like, all right, I at least need a job, that's where I was able to develop, you know, my theater resume and do off-Broadway plays and do a commercial here and there and really start developing my resume so that when I make the transition, I'm not completely starting from scratch.
Mm-hmm. So what did people make of your decision to walk away from that steady Wall Street check?
I had to hide it for a minute.
Really?
Yeah, I mean, I left 9-to-5, you know, traditional employment, and I didn't tell anybody, with the exception of my mom. She's the only person that I told. You know, I confided in her, and she was good with it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, luckily I did it in such a way where it took me a little longer than some others. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, it was a slow but steady progression. Mm. Nice. So I was never, quote unquote, you know, homeless, like a lot of actors say they lived out of their cars.
That's a blessing.
Not with a Howard education degree and a loan I was paying off.
No,
I was
sir.
Like, nah.
It had to work somewhere.
Yeah, I got to make that degree work for me now.
Right. So, okay. Yeah. So tell us, we've been hearing rumors about a Jumping the Broom sequel.
Yeah.
Please tell us it's true.
You know, I'm hoping that it is true. We still don't know. Sony, for some reason, is sleeping on that franchise.
Well, it was such a hit.
It was a hit.
Yeah.
They spent $6 million to make. They made over $50 million at the box office, not including DVDs and everything else after that. Sony needs to get on it and make this a three-parter.
All right, Sony, you heard that.
Get on it, Sony.
Please,
let's do it.
Get on it, Sony.
You know what my pitch was?
What?
Jumping the Broom 2, she's pregnant.
Yeah.
And we go through the childbirth and all the craziness that goes around two families trying to claim the baby.
And you
and
know
how it's going to be raised and all this other stuff.
I know your mother on the movie will be having
Loretta Devine will kill
that.
It. Absolutely.
Right, exactly.
Well, we like that pitch, and we can't wait to see you again.
Thank you.
And continued success.
Thank you so much.
Right. We'll be checking you out on The Mysteries of Laura.
Now, Wednesday nights, 8 p.m. on NBC.
We're there.
Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
And we'll be right back with more Rise Entertainment 360.